Good afternoon, everybody. Always difficult to come and meet up for a post-lunch session. I think most of us want to be in a nap, but lovely to see a crowd here, and lovely to be on stage with wonderful people, Annie Zaidie, Paul Zacharia, of course, and Aienla from the publishing industry. I am a journalist, nothing to do with books, and looking forward to this session. I thought I'd start off by with the question that we're trying to address: how Indian is our English, and then maybe all of us can really, you know, try and talk about it. If that question were posed to me, I think our English is very Indian. It's a language we have completely made our own. It's very different from English as she is speak. You know, we do our own thing with it. And it's very much an Indian language today. The rhythms are different. The ways in which we use words and phrases are different. So, and there's, I see this as a good thing. And I see this as a wonderful sort of growth in the ways in which in the unusual ways in which languages have a tendency of growing and sort of surprising us all the time. And that's my take on this, but I would love to hear from all of you. Yeah, Annie, if you would. Yeah.
But the question of whether or not English is an Indian language, I think, settled at least 100 years ago. I think with, as with all language, the whole thing of it's deeply connected to the ideas of identity and nationhood. What we call India is 70 years old. In English as a language has been in the subcontinent for much longer than that, at least 500 years before that, because there were traders coming, going, etc. And English as a sort of language of power, if I may call it that, has been there for at least 200 years. So I think this is a little bit of an old debate. I also feel like now English is, for a lot of people in my generation, generation of writers, and certainly for the upcoming generations, there are a lot of people who say English is their first language. Absolutely. And their only language. Yeah. And they're completely Indian in the sense that it's not that their parents have migrated or anything. Their parents' first language is something else. But the children's first language is English. And I think there's a lot of anxiety about it now. Why should it be English? I mean, that's a different question. Why should it not be English? But that's how it is right now. Mm. I think so. This is more or less a dusted debate. Mm. There's also a lot of anxiety about the fact that nobody does English the way it's meant to be done, or any other language the way it's meant to be done. So there's a lot of criticism of young people ki they can't speak Hindi properly, they can't speak English properly, they can't speak Malayalam properly, they can't speak any language properly. So this notion of what is proper is also a kind of new question, I think, an evolving question.
That's interesting, Annie, some of the points you make. We can come back to those, but Aienla, if you would.
I will talk about how English is, how Indian is our English. I think it's a distinctive language that we have created. I would like to use Salman Rushdie's example. When he first started, when he submitted his book Midnight's Children in 1981, he told the publishers and the world that he does not want any of the Indian words that he had used in his novel to be italicized or glossed. The reason being, his rationale was very simple. He said, if I as an Anglophone reader can read a book which has Latin terms, German terms, French terms without them being italicized or without them being explained, why should, you know, why should Indian English or Indian English be treated differently? So so that's how I think it's Indian English is a distinctive language. We should be celebrating it, in fact. And also, it is also, again, I'll go back to Rushdie, where in the novel he talks about chutneyfication. So I think Indian language is a glorious chutneyfication of our history, our culture. It's a slight alteration. It's a slight adjustment of to the parent language, I would say, the British language that we have that we inherited from the English, and then we made it our own language.
I think we have reached a point, that is, English has reached a point where The only question that remains is how much more can we misuse it actually on a day-to-day basis? Because it's simply torn to pieces. We have become so attuned to this language. It's so much part of everything, right from the bureaucracy in Trivandrum, in Kerala, for example. Not many people know English in that sense, but all transactions are in English. The bureaucracy can't put pen on paper unless they make the jotting in English.
Yes.
It has reached, you know, seeped into such levels. But if you read the jottings, then you get a shock. Only the alphabet is English. The rest is some strange language which we will not understand. But nevertheless, it so happens that I think we are a manpower exporting state. So I think every year, maybe 1 million young people leave Kerala because they know English reasonably well. They have a working knowledge of English. So it's something that has come into our lives in a big way. Whether it was the result of colonialism, etc., colonialism is a fact. It's a given fact. We can't change it anymore. If the British came here and took us over, but I think one of the good things that British did to Indians is bringing us this language of English. In Kerala, for example, I know I can only speak about this state. It's one of the instruments of enlightenment, of scientific ideas, of a larger worldview. We wouldn't have known many of the things. It is through English that the communist movement came to Kerala. We are the pioneers of the communist movement, if you ask me. And I'm very proud of that too. But it is English that brought leftist ideas. So that way, today it is part and parcel of, in fact, I am told that English medium schools are overtaking Malayalam medium schools, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. That's because you have to import, we have to export our children. Mm. I'm not blaming anybody for that. Mm. So I think, Vaishnavi, it's very much part of our...
I think it ties in with what Annie said, spoke of it as a language of power. But more so now, of course, it's a bridge language for Indians because we speak so many different languages across the length of the country. But I think it's also a language of success, is it not? That whole business of upward mobility is granted by the knowledge of English, which has, I think, become something inevitable. As you yourself spoke, if the language of bureaucracy, for instance, is English... You know, you use the word misuse, but as long as the language is understood by the people using it, I would even be wary of the word misuse because it's just more adaptation. They have adapted it in the ways in which they speak, and that is interesting. But what's also interesting is that one of the reasons this session was organized was because Amitav won the Njanpith. But he himself has said that he does not want to be categorized as writing in Indian English, which also is the position that Jhumpa Lahiri also said that. She's not comfortable being slotted in that category of Indian English. So the question then is, is it time for us to just take this as one of the languages and stop treating it? I mean, why are we making it a big deal that this award was given? Is it not just an Indian language already?
I think because of the colonial... I think because of what colonization does, people are very... wary of everything that colonizing involves, including language imperialism and cultural imperialism, etc. I think a lot of the struggle against English and kind of rejecting English as an Indian language and people who do write in English rejecting then that additional burden of an Indian English, which will then be compared to the global stage of global English. How is our English in any way superior or inferior to that? And all those anxieties do play in. I actually would like to bring in, for example, the question of Urdu and Hindi, for instance. There is, along with, if you see, Urdu is also a constructed language. It's been around sort of for at least 700 years, and people keep talking about it's dying, it needs to be saved. And there's also this whole politics around it, around whether or not it should be encouraged and allowed. And there's also the politics of when it diverges from Hindi, if it diverges from Hindi. And it was never the official state language. It was always Farsi, and from Farsi it went directly into English. So I think when it comes to languages, we are in general very anxious about what part of our identities ties into that. And with English, Indian English, what's happened is that it's a big part of our cultural identity and who we are, but we are unwilling to give it the formal kind of label that this defines us.
It also ties into the whole idea of the politics around the language, isn't it, Paul? For instance, the whole movement to remove, in Tamil Nadu, for instance, the whole bring back Tamil movement, and then the ideas of removing the Sanskritization of that language and making it more Dravidian. So how would you then define the politics around, say, Indian English and existing politics around all languages, especially because identities are tied up with it?
I think in Tamil Nadu, for example, the Tamilians weren't agitating against English, as you know. They were agitating against Hindi, about the imposition of Hindi. Now, the interesting thing here is that they found English a neutral language when it came to a struggle between two equally powerful Indian languages. So when the Tamilians and many other Malayalis, I don't think Malayalis were very much involved in the anti-Hindi movement. But when the Tamilians, the Dravidians, believed that Hindi was being imposed, they didn't say anything against English. So to the extent, which means they had put some trust in English as a language which was neutral in its behavior or in its assertions towards Indians or to the Tamilians, whereas basically it used to be a language of colonial power, as Annie was saying. And I have a feeling it still continues to be a language of urban power, bureaucratic power, and believe it or not, I think as many of you know, courts of law in almost every state in India, including the Supreme Court, the proceedings are conducted in English.
Yes.
Whereas the people who stand around, the man who has come with a petition, and the lawyer who argues for him, and the defendant and his lawyer, and very often the defendant and the person who has made a petition, both of them, they don't understand a word of English. So you are listening to some drama that is going on about you, and you don't know what is going on. So it is, what I'm saying is, English is here in that sense. In that sense, it's a very dangerous language, because you are closing off from the people a very vital part of their citizens' right by not speaking to them in a language which they know. But once you leave these problems, which are related to the, as you said, politics and power, etc., today it is a common man's. I mean, most of the newspapers which people read, and some of the most popular newspapers of India are English newspapers, like Times of India or The Hindu or whichever. You don't have to name them. So many of them are in English, and people find out what is written, what's the news. They trust them. So I think, as Annie said, and the discussion itself is almost inviolate. But if I do remember an argument, I think when Rushdie said the chutneyfication or whatever, I think what he said was that Indian writers were not as good, Indian writers in the mother tongues were not as good Indian writers in English. I think that's what he said, which is highly contestable.
Yeah. He implied something like that. Yeah. But if we move away from the politics of the language and this whole business of how much we use English is bizarre, because there are a whole set of esoteric administrative laws, you know, the tiny ones, which have never been translated into local tongues. So people are just completely dependent on British era sort of tomes which are sitting there very often. And now, recently, I don't know if you people have followed it, there has been a move to tell judges to write their judgments in more accessible English, because so they're trying to train judges to write shorter, crisper sentences and not just, you know, their language is so incomprehensible to not even the common man, to anybody. So there are problems with English at various levels. But if we were to focus on the aspect of writing in English and English literature, you know, growing up in the 70s and 80s, we studied something which was thrust down our throats for many of us was English literature. Please note, we didn't study literature. We studied English literature, which was bizarre. Because very often we were, you know, talking of the Lake District and we were talking of the English romantics, and we were talking of flowers and vegetation and fruits, which we had never seen. And this was being thrust. And for me, at least, we were not even introduced to some of the very powerful English writing that was happening at that time. So in many ways, I think that I think is changing now. Of course, many departments have done away with it. Still exists as a category. English literature is something we study. It's funny because we should just be studying literature, perhaps. But having said that, I think it influenced a whole generation, not just in the language they used, but also in the themes that they were talking about, or in the ways in which their worldview was getting formed. How would you, as a writer, approach that question of, you know, what we studied as academics when we were studying, literature, for instance?
I think the literature that I studied in school has almost completely, it's a blank in my mind. I don't know if I got much out of it. But to kind of come back to this, I would say that I was left colder by the Hindi that I was taught in school than the English, because the Hindi was far worse. It was a kind of Hindi that nobody spoke, that nobody speaks even today. The poetic themes were far too grand for little children. At least the English poems were okay for, you know, an 8 or 10 year old. It's okay. I can read Macavity, The Mystery Cat, and enjoy it. But I cannot understand the kind of language that was kind of given to us. So I think that when you give children, especially anything, they take it and they make what they will out of it. And sure, I read daffodils and I'd never seen a daffodil, but it didn't kill me, you know, to not know what a daffodil was. It was a small thing. And I would have liked and appreciated.
But did you miss not knowing what a Rajinigandha was, for instance, or studying a poem or reading a poem about a Rajinigandha?
I knew what a Rajinigandha was. That's the thing.
Did you miss the poetry around it?
No, I didn't, because the poems were so dense and written in languages and themes and filled with metaphors that are not suitable for a 12-year-old. It's not that they're bad poems. It's just that there was this absolute disconnect between the child's world and the poetry that was being imposed on school syllabuses. They are suitable for, say, undergraduate or postgraduate level poems. So this is what I'm saying, that I think the bigger problem was not the fact that the English was foreign. More Indian, authentic, son of the soil kind of Indian English poems were welcome, but I don't think they're damaging in any way in your sense of your own imagination. I never felt compelled to write about daffodils.
All right. So my experience was slightly different, I have to confess, because I think I came across some wonderful Hindi poetry which completely, you know, touched me as much as reading Keats did or Yeats did. Aienla, what was your experience?
My experience, Hindi, English. Hindi, I think I kind of agree with what Annie said, because if you're talking about how, Hindi should be, or, you know, some other language apart from English should be the common language, I think it would be very difficult. I mean, it would have been difficult for me because, you know, I come from a state where, you know, we have 16, 17 dialects. We don't have a common...
Aienla, which state are you from?
From Nagaland.
From Nagaland.
So we have... There are many tribes. Each tribe has a different dialect. We have a pidgin language which we use in the... It's not an official language, so English is our official language. So all the education that we have had, the books that we have read, are all in English. But I'm also very, you know, it's only after I came to university that I started reading about works by Indian writers, which were translated into English. So I think the works that were translated from various languages like Malayalam, Tamil, or Hindi, Urdu, we came to that late in life. I mean, I came to that late in life. But what's very encouraging to see these days is that all the publishers, almost all the publishers in India, we publish translations of various works, works that really matter, works we think should be read by everyone. And then those works can only be read by, it can be read by people who are fluent in that language. But like, for example, Paul Zacharia's short stories. I can't read them in Malayalam, but since they have been translated into English, and we are also doing a translated work of his collection of his translated works, then that's how, you know, I came to know about what the rich literature of our country. The same with Urdu. We did a collection of short Urdu stories. That's when I came to read about Manto. That's a very bad example. Let's say Kotlan Haider. Or from Tamil, let's say Takili. Takili is Tamil, right? So all this, all the great writers, all the great literature that we have in this country, I can only access through translation, through English.
Which is very true. A lot of languages I do access to translation. We will come back to the idea or the question of translations. But before that, Paul, if I were to ask you to design a curriculum for literature at the undergrad level, and if I would ask you to, if I were to tell you that, we are sort of, one feels overwhelmed by the Western canon of philosophy and literature that is constantly there, how would you come up with something that might perhaps be more universal, perhaps, or more far-reaching?
That's a curriculum for children.
I thought maybe undergrads.
Undergrads. I think I am afraid you asked the question to the wrong person, because I am very sentimental about English literature. So I cannot but help. That I will simply go back to the classical literature. I will go back to all the great poets of right from, the first poem to Beowulf to Down. I will stick to that, because if you're learning a language, you might as well learn it properly. Okay. And learn it from the roots, learn it the right way. You cannot reassemble a language for Indians per se, especially the literature. So I think if we go about teaching English, then of course it has to be easy.
So if I could rephrase my question a bit, because I think if you were to pick literature as a subject, not English, but if literature and the humanities is something that is essential to be taught, then what sorts of works would you like to see included in that to this fresh undergrad mind?
I think, I will say that I will go by the by the well-known periods in English literature, whether it is fiction or poetry or theatre or drama or whatever. And I would like people to undergraduate to study a little bit of, to be exposed to each one of them until they reach the contemporary English literature, if it is there. I'm not very sure about whether there is a contemporary English literature. Anyway, if it is there, well, I think they should be exposed to that also. So, that seems to be the case for me.
All right. So, and you write in Malayalam?
Yeah, I do. I write in Malayalam.
But you are now writing your first, one of your first books is to be released today, which is primarily.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. So, why essentially did you make that?
I think it's a choice that I made very late, if you ask me. Because for me, both languages are equally important. I love both Malayalam and English equally. As a reader, the most important thing I have to say is that as a reader, I grew up reading, my foundation reading has been in Malayalam. And then I moved on to English when I picked up English. I think I heard English spoken or I saw it in a book proper when I was 16 or so. That's the time. And that's when I got familiar with English, when I heard somebody speaking English, etc., etc. And then I started reading books in English. So I've been in love with English books, both fiction and non-fiction. So Malayalam has, as a very young language, it has many limitations, especially in the areas of knowledge. And even in the matter of writing, you know, in the matter of poetry or fiction or anything, we are still growing. We are just starting out, actually. It's only the first work of fiction in Malayalam is only about 100 years old. So 150 years old, maybe. Not even that, I think. So we have a problem there. So somebody like me who would like to explore and inquire and look into a larger world, for me, English was the only choice. That's only. So when I shifted from writing in Malayalam to English, I was simply making the same choice as a reader, as I did as a reader, shifting from Malayalam to English.
Yeah.
So this is how it happened.
So for the, as the four of us sitting on the panel here, we also come from positions of privilege, do we not, which made us study English. A position which now might not necessarily be available for everybody, and which will make a very large number of people comfortable in writing in what you spoke of, English as being your first language, for example, when they would write in their own first languages, which could be Tamil or which could be Telugu or Bengali. And we have seen amazing works come out of those languages and amazing works which are now finally being translated into English in order to reach a much larger readership, and importantly being translated well in English rather than just, you know, it's not just the words which have to be, you know, transliterated, but there has to be the spirit of the novel as well, and that's happening. So in that sense, English for me continues to be a bridge language and is very important as a bridge language. But this whole focus on translations that we are now beginning to see in India, how do you view that, Annie?
I think I come back to the question of power, because why is English a bridge language? Why are these brilliant works not coming to us in our... So for instance, when I say English is almost my first language, I am equally fluent in both Hindi and English. It's not that I am predominantly fluent in English. But the fact is that I was sent to an English medium school and my literary training is in English. Now, for me, there are many other texts that have also come to me in Hindi from other languages. Say Punjabi translated into Hindi, something else translated into Hindi, that has also come to me. There is this huge emphasis and conversation about English because we operate in English. This is the thing. We operate in English. We draw income from English. And finally, publishing is very heavily skewed towards English. For a writer of Malayalam to sort of make it in a way is not just to reach other Indians, but also that opens up the whole world of international publishing. So English is a language of global power. There's no getting away from that.
In the context of what Annie said, if we could speak of the whole Perumal Murugan incident and before his book was banned and before he stopped writing, very few people outside Tamil Nadu knew about Perumal Murugan. So how does that reflect on the factor of reach that Annie spoke of?
Annie, bad girl.
We'll put the cat in the worms.
I think it's because English language publishers, we're ignorant of, you know, what's happening in the regional language publishing.
Yes.
And I think we need to have more open and frequent dialogue between the two between the two worlds. Having said that, I was just talking to Shrikant of Mathrubhumi yesterday, and we were talking about how, you know, because I was asking him, because I'm really interested in what's happening in Malayalam literature. So the ones that I know of have been translated, and we all know about those authors, but I asked him, do you have any distinctive, exciting novel that, you know, which hasn't been published, but you think, you know, needs to be published, people need to read about them. So do you have such kind of books? He said, of course, I have a list. I can send you a list. And then we started talking. And he came up with this brilliant plan, idea of, okay, so you translate a work into English from Malayalam. That English language translation, why don't you also give it out to other languages,
yes,
publishers
exactly,
in other languages, exactly. So that, you know, everyone, whether people are reading in English, in Marathi, in Urdu, in Punjabi, can read the same literature, can read the same book. Now, the thing with, of course, you know, English is a cool language. It's cool to know English, and then that's how you progress in life, or, you know, that's how you have made it. But at the same time, I think the Indian English that we have created, which is, as I keep saying, it's distinctive. There's a statistics which say that it will overtake Indian. It will become globally relevant. So, for example, when we say in Hindi, we say "Apka shubh naam kya hai?" So in English, we would say "What's your good name?" Or we use, in Hindi, we use a lot of the present continuous tense. So we say, I'm thinking it's going to rain this evening. Or, you know, I'm leaving tomorrow morning. But those are not incorrect. Those are Indian English, which, you know, are slowly or have joined the mainstream. That's how we speak. That's how we speak Indian English. So I think, I don't know whether I met my point or not. I think I was just going all over.
Yes, please, yes.
You know, as a writer, what I find is that, you know, we have, I think, 23 languages, operational languages in India, 23 or 24, I think, recently. We have added one more. You know, each one of these languages, and every writer or people who express themselves in each one of these languages, they function within the island of that particular language. I don't know how many, because I happen to have Tamil friends, I know who are the prominent Tamil writers. Because I happen to have Kannada friends, because I know who are the major Kannada works writers today. But finally, the only way, because we don't have a common language for very political, very genuinely political reasons, like when Hindi was trying to be imposed on the rest of India, people rose up against it, because you cannot afford to have one of these languages dominating these 23 languages. It's a fact of life. So with the result, so all these things added together, it so happens that only English is now bridging these 23 languages in through translations. And that's where publishers like Aienla and others, Alep and so many others, who are bringing English translations of from the better writers or the finest writers from these languages. And that's how the rest of India gets to read these mother tongues today. I don't know if there will be a change from this later sometime, I don't know when, but right now this seems to be the reality.
I think it's yes, of course, it's a reality. It's I don't see anything bad with it. I think it's good. It's necessary. It's the country needs something like that. It's just the diversity of languages is a practical problem, and this is a practical solution. So that's fine with me. I think the second thing, which is also happening under the radar, so to speak, is translations between Indian languages. So Tamil's getting translated a lot into Malayalam. Bengali is getting translated a lot into Malayalam. Malayalam is getting translated in Bengali, and so on across the country. And that is a second movement which is sort of bringing works and bringing that exposure that is so important that we're talking about. Aienla and Annie said something which is, and you as well, Paul, When you spoke of English being, you know, the English translation finally bringing the spotlight on a book, which is why I, you know, spoke of the Perumal Murugan experience, because he's written brilliant books which, you know, almost nobody in the English speaking world was familiar with, except a handful of people. And then when One Part Woman became so controversial, everybody, of course, you know, bought a copy. Many people bought a copy in order to make a point, you know, in order to buy a book that the government was trying to ban. And then very soon after that, Pyre was published as well in translation. And it's stunning. The work is just stunning. And then I was talking to Perumal's publisher, Kannan. And Kannan spoke of how with Pyre and One Part Woman and the sort of impact that it had, it made in the Indian sort of reading context, he instantly was able to make deals with a whole bunch of publishers in Australia and England and so on and so forth. So, which, all of which was a first for a Tamil writer. And it was a major first. So very sarcastically, they would say things like, you know, now we get invited to Litfest. There was a time when nobody heard us, nobody would call us for Litfest. So as publishers, Aienla, how can we not make this a sort of, panel discussion for every Litfest, but actually in reality, in a day-to-day kind of thing, how can publishers open up translations of Indian writers to much vaster readerships?
I think we can begin by publishing, translating their works and then sharing it or taking it to a wider audience. I think that's one way to spread the idea. The other way is also, okay, for example, if we... Okay, now the thing is about Perumal Murugan's incident, you know, when it was banned and then all the English language. So the thing is that I'm not trying to defend us, but I mean, I was just coming from a logical point of view. Okay, I don't read Tamil, so how would I know, you know, what the book is about? So, I think, you know, it was good that, you know, that it was banned. Yeah. So then, you know, that's how. So maybe it was not good for them because if they had to go through legal battles and have to incur losses, that's not a good thing. But sometimes, you know, all these bad things happen so that something good happens out of them. So I think banning the book and then people getting to know about the book, how important it was, and then it being translated into so many languages around the world.
So I was wondering, actually, that was my question. Is there an ecosystem, a practical ecosystem that can be created in order to bring translated works into the public eye? Do you have something to say?
I think publishers have to get... Basically, I think it's not individual publishers or even a group of them who can do it. The agency that should do it is the government of India or a central agency like that who should be able to sit down. In fact, there was an amazing project about 7, 8, 9 years back. I think Professor Bhishma Narayan Singh, if I remember right, was in charge of that. It started from Mysore. I think it was called Translating India. It was a massive project of translations. And it was funded by the government, whosoever was in power at that time. I think it was a Congress or whatever. Anyway, it was a wonderful project. And it is only that kind of projects of an agency, a central agency, with a lot of money and influence behind it, who can do this kind of a project of linking. But that was... As soon as the government changed, I think they abandoned this particular project.
Yes.
This is what happened, which is very unfortunate. And I, you know, here is Joe sitting here from Germany. He has been trying to translate books, Indian literature, into German and publish it. And this particular project had supported him. And then suddenly he found himself in deep waters.
Yes.
Because the support vanished.
Yeah. I think you made a very important point, Paul, the fact that there is no sort of central and large project that that prioritizes translation and trains translators sponsors translations, and you know, we are not talking of distributions. We are not, for instance, saying that the government of India will buy 100 copies of every translated work for every public library in the country. We are just not talking along those lines. And unless we do that, I think there's a whole lot of very rich literature that is going to get lost and not get half the attention that it deserves. Sorry, sir, give me 2 minutes because I have someone there telling me that the session has to end. So I will cut the session short here and ask for questions and answers. So.
Can you repeat that? Our Central Sahitya Academy is supposed to do it, and they have done. They are publishing a magazine, Indian Literature, and there you will find poetry and that prose pieces, whether it is a short story or extracts from novels and all these things, from different languages of India, translated into English. It is there. And books also, Tagore and many others.
And I think now they're also talking of putting it online, which is going to be like a treasure trove. They're talking of that.
And
as
then
well.
That about the history of Indian literature, that we have got this 23 or 500 literature we have got, this major languages, literature of the major languages, they have published the history in different volumes. Sahitya Academy.
Right. I would add to what he said. It is not the Sahitya Academy alone. Even the National Book Trust is supposed to do it. Do you agree or?
National Book Trust is different.
Different thing. Okay.
Purpose is different. They are publishing. But you will not find much fiction in National Book Trust. You will not find much fiction.
This question you are from?
Indian English is what we, when I went to Singapore, I wanted tea. I said tea. 10 minutes I waited, he was not able to follow. I don't know what happened. Then in my house where I was staying, is a Chinese wife. So she told me, we are going macaque. I said, what is? So I cannot ask them what is. He's a doctor, his wife is Chinese. Market. Market. So market and market. Why is we going to market only once in a week? It's all right. So Indian English and this thing, you know, when I wanted to meet the Singapore Minister of Education, so, because I wanted to introduce my book, so I know that what I speak will not be understandable by the receptionist. So I asked so many people, can you speak for me? But fortunately, when I talked to her, she understood it. And her language, I was able to understand. The minister is not here, he's on tour, which I didn't believe, because he wanted to avoid me. So I went to the minister's place, he was not there. So this, and the translation is something which, you mean to say, this... I translated and sent it to so many people. One Kasturba Gandhi, no return. Maybe because
Kasturba Gandhi. So I think that's a good point. Maybe we should popularize Indian English as well. Are there any other questions?
Very popular. It's generally a conversation about the Indian English writing and overcoming of the regional languages in literature. So I have just one question that whether English writing is overpowering the vernacular languages or literature, because I have asked this question only because of one thing, because even Rabindranath Tagore had to translate his work into English to receive a Nobel Prize. Is this a good trend or not?
Look, see, this is why I keep coming back to power, because you keep talking, all your references are international, right? You're not talking about Rabindranath Tagore winning a Bengali Prize. You're talking about him winning the Nobel. Obviously, the Nobel Committee doesn't read Bangla. How are they going to give a prize to Bangla writers? If all the prizes, if all the power that is attached to name, fame, the fact that your work reaches all corners of the globe, there has to be some way of doing it, right? How is that going to happen? If you write by default, the fact that you write in a so-called quote-unquote regional language means it is specific to a certain region. How do you expect that region to transform into the whole globe without the work being transmitted into another language? It's impossible. Well, it is impossible. It's not going to happen very quickly unless...
My question is that trend possible for the literature to overcome the barriers of language and even the barriers of literature and of nations? So, is that a good trend or not? That's my question. Not it is whether it is possible or impossible, but whether it is a good trend or not.
I think that...
I don't know how to answer that question.
Annie, if I could just... I'm just trying. You know, you speak of overcoming barriers. I think the act of translation is an overcoming of a barrier. So when a translated work, when a work is translated in English, therefore reaches a wider reading public, therefore gets an award, not just the work, but the language it's written in is also crossing barriers. And there is then going to be much more work in and around that language because it broke that barrier. So I think if you want a straight, good, yes, no answer, yes, I think it's a good thing that that translation is happening.
A translation is not a hostile act. You see, you should remember that. It's a friendly act. It's an act of crossing barriers and taking you across. So I don't think by translating Gitanjali into English, anybody was doing Tagore any harm. Or by translating Gitanjali into Malayalam, anybody was planning to destroy Tagore. No. Yeah, but it's only when it was translated, the wider world could read him. That I think that's what happened. We shouldn't misunderstand.
It's a suggestion. I would like to make a suggestion. In the scenario of literature, in the area of Malayalam literature, a lot of foreign books are coming through the way of translation. Translation will naturally affect the culture of the country too. But the books translated from Western countries into Malayalam language, and they are actually translated with no standard. Let me make an excuse about it.
Quality standard.
Their qualities are not at all maintained. Great books from English literature, for example, Sons and Lovers, Lawrence's book, translated into Malayalam as Kamukarum, Putrammarum, Kaminimarum. Putrammarum, Kaminimarum. That sons and lovers. Sons as lovers is the hidden meaning. And even the title cannot simply bring the impact, the suggestions given by the writer. So a lot, without any scruples, without any principles, a lot of books are translated and the ordinary people always think that this is the standard English, this is the author telling us, and all that. And I think there should be a platform to discuss all these atrocities done to language. Classics are distorted, and here, when Zacharia sir and such people are here, and they can just take up this issue sometime somewhere. Thank you.
Paul.
You did make a point, but there are good translations also once in a while. But I agree that most translations are bad. So there is no solution because each publisher must create his own standards, must apply those standards very strictly and severely, and make sure that you have a good product and a truthful product that conveys the original into Malayalam. But that is not happening. Then all that you can say here is that, well, some sort of a communication is going on, but I think it is very misleading because, as you said, it's very poorly done. It's very poorly done.
You know, we come back to the question, if I may, Paul, we have to create an ecosystem where translations are prioritized. And that's not going to happen, to again go back to Annie's point, unless the economics are in favor of it. Translators are paid poorly. Translators are often not recognized, so you're not getting the best writers doing the translation. This is very slowly changing, and once it reaches a point where doing a translation is worth your while, I think you will attract then the best minds to it, and then quality will automatically improve. And I think you need schools. I think you need, like I said, you need a whole ecosystem. Anybody else? Sorry, this gentleman's waiting for a long time.
I have two questions on the original topic. That is, how far can Indians write in English? That is the original topic. So, deviating from the discussion, now I will ask these two questions. How authentic can an Indian author writing in English transport the Indian perceptions, the Indian experience, the Indian way of thinking, Indian vision? This is one question. The second question is, how far the authors writing in English today are influenced by market situation outside India? For example, the pressures of the market coming on them to sell their books to a Western audience, a Western readership, where they can make a lot of money. Please answer these two questions.
I write in English, mainly in English. I also write in Hindi sometimes, but I write mainly in English. I don't struggle at all to transfer my experience into the English language. I think the real test is, are you thinking in Hindi or are you thinking in English? Are you thinking in Malayalam? Are you thinking in English? I often do think in English. When I feel like I'm not thinking in English, if the words are coming to my head in another language, then I write in that language. But I have not struggled with this. As for the Indian way of thinking, I don't think there is an Indian way of thinking. Look at India. There are like 30,000 ways of thinking. So I don't think that is a question. The market pressures question is a valid one. I don't experience the pressure because I think the way I write, I kind of, if there is any sort of ideal reader in my mind, it is an Indian reader, primarily an Indian reader. I mean, others, if they read and they like it, that's bonus. But I don't think that I can't write, and I don't write with an eye on the Western market. But yes, that's a valid question though. Some people do. There's a lot of mangoes and banyan trees and that kind of writing.
But Paul, this might be a question that I would like to ask you, because you write in Malayalam and now you've written in English. So,
as I was telling you right in the beginning, what I was saying is that for me, both languages, as Annie said about English, both languages are, I am at home, except that I am not very good in speaking English because I didn't grow up in an English-speaking environment. So I hardly ever spoke it. But I am an English reader. So with the result, a lot of my intellectual development, if you can call that, and further development over and above Malayalam of my imagination. That happened in English. So for me, it just flows into my, the moment I want to switch over to English, it comes naturally. There is no gap, there is no break. It is the same mind, same intellect, and same imagination at work, whether it is in Malayalam or in English. But as Joseph was asking, and there is no Indian experience as such. These are all experiences all over the world. It's all the same. When somebody wants to kill somebody, I don't think the American thinks differently than the Indian, unless the religion makes you think differently, you see, for some reason, the sinfulness or whatever. So I don't think there's anything separate in that. But where I may have to think twice is when it comes to, when I am writing in English, when it comes to some technicality which is specifically related to an Indian situation, which may not have an English equivalent, so I will have to pick up the dictionary, or I may have to ring up four or five people and ask them what is going on and what is the word for this. Today, for example, somebody rang me up. He was writing. In the middle of that, he rang me up and asked me, what is the Malayalam for immaculate conception? It was on the tip of my tongue, but I couldn't tell him that. But I am saying you run into this kind of block. You see, as a man who grew up as a Christian, Catholic, immaculate conception is on the tip of my tongue. But he is struggling to get a Malayalam word for that. But I knew it, but I couldn't remember it. What I am saying is, so this is where I have to rethink my. When I am writing in English. Otherwise, I think it's the same process hardly any difference.
Also, the rich sort of, the rich sort of terms that Indians have for relationships, you know, the various kinds of aunts we have, the various kinds of sisters-in-law, English would have just that one term for it. I think situations, also things like maike jana in Hindi, though, how do you, it's not just going to your mother's home, there's a whole cultural construct around maike. So those might be problems, but otherwise, I think, like you said, it's the human experience.
There are three Indo-Anglian poets sitting here.
Yes.
Arundhati and Anupama and here Kartika. Yeah. They are all doing a tremendous job, you see. So, yes, writing poetry is a very difficult thing to do than fiction.